Okay, you can see the presentation. So guys, I'll start with a very brief go through of the presentation, and then we will switch to the practical things. That's the aim of this talk. So my name is Rizwan. Let me first introduce myself, and I'm working with the national telecom company in Pakistan. Its name is Ufone. I'm working as a manager in geo marketing department. And the topic of today's talk is easy dashboards using Kibana. So the aim of the talk is to get you guys with easy data ingestion methods, because as a layman person who is not a techie guy, so this data ingestion is something, a complex thing to start with dashboarding. So we would be talking about the easy data ingestion methods in Kibana, and then we will be talking about the fast dashboarding, how we can create a standard looking dashboard in like 20 to 30 minutes time. And meanwhile, we would also be seeing how we can efficiently doing querying and filtering on the data. So you can say the main aim of the talk is to give a layman or a non-technical person power to present his or her analysis skills in a more effective and robust way. And finally, we would practically be building a COVID-19 dashboard for the world. So let's talk about the agenda of the talk. I got some message, I think. It's not necessary to download the software, because it would be then very lengthy talk. Just listen to the things, and you can practice it yourself afterwards. Okay. So let's talk about the agenda. We would talk about the Elastic Stack, a short introduction. What is Elastic Stack? And then we will be talking about data ingestion mechanisms in Kibana. We would be briefly talking about the mapping and indexing pattern. We'll see the load CSV feature in Kibana, which is experimental, but yet very powerful feature. And finally, we would be making some visualizations, some graphs, some pie charts, some maps. And finally, would be merging all those visualization together to build a dashboard. So guys, let's get started. Let me just show you the kind of dashboard we would be making in the end of this talk. So let me share my screen. So guys, can everybody see the screen? Can everybody see this dashboard? So if you have a look at this dashboard is being developed in like 20 to 30 minutes time. So that's the kind of skill I'm going to deliver today. So you can see that there is this date filtering option, then there's this country selection control menu, then there are these, you know, indicator values, total confirmed cases, top country, and then there is this line chart showing the top five countries death-wise. And under this section, there are the statistics of Pakistan only, the confirmed cases in Pakistan, and the daily and the cumulative cases in Pakistan. So this data is a little old, because I developed this dashboard on the 14th of April. So that's why it is showing Italy as the top death country, but I believe that now USA is on the top. So we would be creating this kind of dashboard visualizations by ourselves. So let us just get started with the presentation. So a little theory first, and then we will move to the practical. So the first thing is ELK stack. So what is ELK stack? So this ELK, in ELK, E stands for Elasticsearch, and L stands for Logstash, and K stands for Kibana. So the Logstash is the module in ELK stack, which is used for data ingestion, for data loading. I got some message. Let me just see what people are up to.
You continue, I will answer the questions.
Okay. So, resuming our talk, so Logstash is the module in ELK stack, which is used for data ingestion. And there is this efficient variation of Logstash, which is called Beats. Beats are actually self-capable of fast logging, you can say skip-like programs dedicated for logging purposes, such as system logs or network logs or something like that. Logstash is a general program used for data ingestion. So Logstash supports a variety of languages such as Python and other languages to write down your own script for data ingestion. And there comes the Elasticsearch, which is the integral and the central part of this stack. Elasticsearch is basically a non-SQL, very fast cluster-like search platform for storing, indexing, and analyzing the data. And finally, on top of all these components, there is Kibana. So Kibana is a UI thing. This is the UI interface for dealing with your data. It's very efficient. It's very easy to use. So Kibana is mainly used for the purpose of dashboarding, fast dashboarding. Okay. So in data ingestion, we have talked about the Logstash, Beats, and there's one more thing about this ELK stack, that Elasticsearch provides a range of API capabilities for different languages such as Python. So if anybody is a coder or a programmer, he or she can do a very efficient programming for data ingestion using the API services provided by Elasticsearch. And there comes this load from CSV part, which I'm going to focus in this webinar, because the main aim of this talk is to give a person who is non-technical, who has not much time for, you know, setting up a large, you know, software and do the analysis thing. So this load from CSV part in Kibana is experimental, but very powerful thing. We will be talking more about it in practical part of this. Finally, as you guys know, that maps have become integral part of any dashboard. So for map, we need to have the data in geographical coordinates like latitude and longitude. So we will see in Kibana how we can create map and how we can have the mapping for the map part. So moving onward, we will be looking at mapping and indexing pattern. You know, in Elasticsearch or in any software, schema design is the most important part. So we will see how we can design a very robust design schema at the index level. So that would leverage us in, you know, the dashboard part, how we can create the map and the other visualization. So we will be looking at the mapping types, how we can create different mapping types for different field types, and then how we can use all these mapping types in Kibana. Okay, talking theoretically about the load CSV feature in Kibana, we would be switching back and forth to this presentation in the practical session as well. If you're not being able to grab the sense of something, don't worry about it. We would be switching back and forth to this presentation in the practical session. So this load CSV feature is experimental in Kibana. It's a new feature. It's a very simple feature to ingest a large data set, but there's a limit. That is, I guess, 100 MB. But it is a very powerful feature to ingest data from different formats such as CSV and GeoJSON. And then this load CSV feature gives a data analysis stat capability on the go as well, where you can see what are your top contributing values in the data and some quick stats about your data. This auto detection of field type based on data is also a very powerful part of load CSV feature, because everybody is not used to the mapping types and the schema design kind of things. So this load CSV feature gives this kind of automated wizard-like thing where it looks at your data and decide what should be the best field type for your data. Finally, we would be talking about the ingest pipeline support. Ingest pipeline is a smart way of, you can say, data pre-processing, where you want to do something while pre-processing your data, like creating new fields out of your old fields, or combining two fields, or maybe playing with your fields. So finally, we will be doing some visualization, different visualization types provided in Kibana. We would be talking about the Vega Lite support as well, because Kibana supports basic types of visualization. If somebody is up to making like complex visualization types, then there's a good news that Kibana now supports Vega Lite. Vega Lite is a separate open source graph library. And Vega people, they call themselves grammar, visualization grammar, because they have worked so hard on the visualization grammar that they have like more than 100 types of visualization types. So they have started calling themselves like a visualization grammar. So if somebody is up to making advanced visualization, so he or she can take advantage of this experimental feature in Kibana, which supports Vega Lite. Map is always a tricky part. So my field is also mapping. So I would be telling you the quick tips to create impactful maps, good looking map. And finally, we would be combining all these visualization to build a dashboard. So the case study for this webinar is COVID-19. As you guys know that we are going through this hard time dealing with this pandemic, which has affected almost every country in the world. So I've also shared the data of this very useful website. This is datahub.io. So these guys have prepared data on a daily basis, and this data is available to download. So if I show you quickly the website. So this is the website. Telling novel coronavirus 2019, and the full backup file is like 293 MB. You don't need to download the full data file, because they have put data in different formats for different needs. So if I click this download button, so you can see that there are different types of data here. So for United States, they have created separate data sets at the granular level, like states and county levels. So for today's talk, we would only be focusing on the country level stats. So which is this country aggregated, but since we are dealing with the timeline as well, so most of the analysis will be looking at some indicator like confirmed or death cases, but from the time perspective. So the best data set to use in this dashboarding exercise is the time series data. So if you click this data set, you can see that this is the quick snapshot of the data. So the data has a field date, where this is actually daily data, and then the country, and then province or state, then latitude and longitude of that country, and then three key indicators, which are confirmed cases, recovered cases, and deaths. So I'll just download this data in CSV format. Its size is 2 MB. So I can have it in JSON format, like in 5 MB. Kibana supports both formats, so I'll go with the CSV. So guys, now we are shifting to the practical part. Please let me know if you have any critical question so far. Mr. Sami is moderating this session. Sami, is there any critical question so far? Okay, great. So we are moving to the practical of this webinar. So let me first tell you that Elk Stack, you can have. Okay. There's a small announcement. If you guys have any question about the talk, or you want to ask, or you want to add something, you can write it down. Sami is playing the role of moderator, so he can quickly communicate me, and I can quickly look at it. So if you have any question, you can put it in the message. Okay. So a quick thing before moving. Sorry. So a quick tip before moving to the practical of this webinar. As you know that Elk is an open source software, so you can download it easily and you can set it up on your dashboard, on your desktop or laptop. That's very easy, but it's not part of this webinar, but I can give you a very quick tip about this. If you know the Docker, Docker is another software for downloading, installing, and managing softwares very quickly. You can easily set up Elk Stack. Sami would be talking more about it in his part of the session. So you can set up Elk Stack in like 1 or 2 minutes using Docker on your desktop, on your laptop machine. So it's a very easy thing. I'm sure Sami would be enlightening this thing in his session. And secondly, if you don't have, if you don't want to set it up on your local laptop or desktop, then there is this cloud offering of Elasticsearch, where you can have a trial of Elasticsearch for 16 days, like I have this here right in front of you. So after 16 days, you can purchase a subscription, which is also not that expensive. It's like, I guess, $15 per month, and you can enjoy the leverage of the full Elk Stack. Okay, so I'm going to start it from the scratch. Like I have no visualization, or even I don't have any data. So we would be going through step by step how I ended up making this dashboard, and you guys can also add your sanity in this talk as well. If somebody has some insight and some idea to present information, you can talk to me, you can give me suggestions, so we can have it right away in the dashboard session. So the first thing is, when you would log into your Elk Stack in Kibana, so this is the first window of the Kibana. So here you can see a lot of options on the left side, starting from discover, visualize, dashboard, canvas. So this is a kind of self-explanatory tool. You don't need to spend more time on learning which option is where. So under machine learning, you guys must know that Kibana also supports machine learning, but that's part of its gold subscription. We would not be talking about the machine learning in this webinar, but we would be talking about the foundation of machine learning, obviously. So in machine learning, there is this data visualizer option. So this loading from CSV is actually the part of the machine learning module in Kibana. So even if you have the basic license for Kibana, you won't be able to use the machine learning things, but you would be able to use this data visualizer part of machine learning, because it's free and it's experimental at the time. So there's this option of upload file. So as you can see that you can upload files up to 100 MB. So let me give you a fair idea how much records can roughly be in 100 MB a file if you have a very minimalistic kind of schema. I just uploaded a file of like 50 MB size a couple of days ago, and it came up like more than 5 million records. So 100 MB upload file limit is a decent limit. So let's upload the file that we just downloaded from this datahub.io website. So we downloaded this time series file. If I just open this CSV, just to show you what columns are there in this CSV before importing it in Kibana. Okay, so there's this date field. So the data that we have in this CSV is coming on the daily basis. So date field is like year, then the month, and then the day. And then there is this country, and the latitude and longitude geographical coordinates. This is the center coordinate of that country. And there are these three key indicators: confirmed, recovered, and death. So these are the COVID indicators, COVID confirmed cases, then COVID recovered cases, and the COVID death cases. I want to tell you one thing very important about this CSV, because you guys would be in confusion of while we would be developing visualization. So this data is actually accumulative data. So this is not the daily count of some country. So like if I put a quick filter to, let's say, Belgium. So if you see this date, 4th of February, there was one confirmed case in Belgium. So 4th to, you can say, 1st of March, there was only one confirmed case in the country. So these values are cumulative. These are not the daily values. So the difference in daily and the cumulative is this cumulative field format is basically used by the data researchers who are public health experts, because they do some kind of analysis where they study this. You know, you must have heard this terminology these days, flattening the curve like things. So this cumulative data format supports in that thing. But you guys don't need to worry about the daily. If somebody wants to show the daily confirmed or recovered or death cases in some country, there's a good thing in Kibana that you can play around with the data, and there are a lot of, you know, options like minimum, maximum value, the sum bucket, or the difference, or the cumulative sum. Okay, so if we just import the CSV, so this is analyzing our data. So this is showing the first 1,000 lines of the data in comma separated format. And then there is this quick summary. And here you can see the data stats. So it has already put a date column as a date, and it is showing the top values and then country. And these are the quick stats things. So if I import it, this is asking me what should be the name of the index. So I'm calling it COVID. So index, you can take index as the table name. So index is a synonym to table in NoSQL language. So today's date is 18 April 20. So if you go to, then there's this option, create index pattern. Index pattern, you can take it like views in conventional SQL databases. So index pattern is a way of putting a custom, you know, data format on top of the index. You can have multiple index patterns for one index. So in the advanced section, you can see that it has created a mapping for your CSV document. So here you can see it has given confirm field a type long. So this is automatically detected. If you were to write your own code using Python, using the APIs provided by Elasticsearch, you would have to do this thing yourself. But here this is doing itself. So what I'll do, there's not a geography or a geo point field. So I have to do only two things, and then I would be go with the visualization thing. First, I would have to provide an extra mapping, which is not in my CSV, and which is a location. So I'll call it location, and I call it a type geo point. So this geo point is a native Elasticsearch geographical point location type. Used for creating map. And here you can say that this is ingest pipeline. So this is pre-processing part. Here you can write any kind of script to pre-process your data. Like we have to do that, we have created this new mapping with the name location and type geo point, but we don't have this in our CSV data. So we would create this location mapping on the fly by writing a small piece of ingest pipeline script code. I have it written in my text document. Let me just copy it here and then demonstrate. So in ingest pipeline, there are processors. So I've used one processor, its name is append. Actually, geopoint is nothing but to put your latitude and longitude put together and to create one geographical coordinate. So this pre-processing ingest pipeline is doing nothing but appending these two fields, one with the name lat. Here we have this field in our CSV type double. So we are just going to I tested it.
Okay.
So if we import this, please let me know if you have any question about this part, because this is the most tricky part, because mapping is very important. You won't be able to do it afterwards, although it is possible, but this is the part where you need to pay your attention to put your index in a proper mapping, so that you can create maps, you can create date like analysis and other stuff. So if I import it, you can see that file processing has been started, then index has been created, then ingest pipeline created, data has been uploaded, and then index pattern created. So that's it. So in just a matter of a second time, this has ingested 22,968 records in the index. So we can quickly visualize the index in our discover part. If you click the discover, you can see your data in a plain CSV format in Kibana before going into the visualization part. So as you see, if I click this index pattern, and there are the available fields. So if I add country and then confirm deaths and recovered. So you can see that this is a quick look of your data. So if you just unfold this, you can see the whole data, even the location field as well. So now you can see that the date is properly in a date format and location is properly in a location format required for Elasticsearch. So this small icon of the globe is saying that the location is in the right format. And then we have these key indicators showing the number format. So now we are good to go to the visualization part, which is here in visualize. So this is a fresh installation, so I don't have any visualization. Otherwise, they would have appeared here in this visualize panel. So I'm going to create a new visualization. So here you can see the basic visualization types supported in Kibana. You can create an area graph. I will be talking about the basic types, and then if you guys ask, we can talk about the advanced types as well. So the area line chart is there, pie chart is there. You can create a map. We will quickly create a map as well. Gauge, goal, heat map, horizontal bar, data table. So these are the basic types supported in Kibana. But as I mentioned earlier in my presentation, that Kibana now supports Vega. Let me just show you Vega Lite website. See, this is the website of the Vega Lite. They call themselves a grammar of interactive graphs. So these kind of graphs can be created in Vega. So when I say the Vega is supported in Kibana, that means you can create advanced visualization types supported in Vega right in the Kibana. So let's start with the famous line chart where we can show top countries, how their death or confirmed lines in going with respect to time. So we'll click this line. Now this will ask which index pattern you want to use. I already have an index pattern with the name test. I'm not going to use it because I just created it for testing purpose. I'll use this COVID-19-world-18-April-20 index pattern that I just created earlier. Okay, so let me just give you an overview of this the theme of the visualization. The theme is same for every kind of visualization. On the top here you have the search window. You can search anything. This is an open text search. You can search like name of a country or cases or anything. Here you can add any kind of filter. This is very interactive, like you can select any country, region, and then operator, and then the name of the countries will pop up automatically. And then there is this date. Sorry, can we have more time? Because
yeah, we can have more time, but you can show me this line chart.
Okay.
And maybe one of the gauges.
Okay, so Mr. Samir is saying that we are left with 2 minutes. So we will just quickly create this graph, and then we will, after, yes, we will have more time for this dashboard thing after the Q&A session. So this is the date menu where you have, you can select your date range on the absolute or relative way. So this is absolute. Date range already selected from looking at the data. This is being done automatically because the data that we imported from this index pattern, it is from 22nd January to 17 April. So we have two options here. One is metric. Here we will define our metrics, sum or average or min or max, any kind of metrics for the key indicators, confirmed deaths and the recovered patient. And here you can create a bucket. So bucket is like x-axis and matrix is like the y-axis. So let's start with the creating a bucket. So I'm adding an x-axis bucket. Sorry. So here I have a lot of options. So I'm not going into more detail about these options. Just two, we will be discussing two options. So like if I select term, so it is asking me which field do you want? So I'm saying that country. So I want to see top five countries. So this is my bucket, and in the metric part, I can choose sum. So I can say I want to see the sum of confirmed cases. So this will show the sum of countries, top five countries. So this is order by descending. If I just click this play, apply changes button. So you can see that on the x-axis, you have top five countries, and this line is showing the confirmed cases.
This is
not the sum, as I mentioned earlier. This is cumulative, because this is adding up every day information. So there is this another option in the aggregation part where you can use this serial difference. So what is serial difference? Serial difference means you want to see these stats on the basis of daily. So I'll just choose some here, and then I'll choose the confirmed cases. So this option works with the date histogram, because this is with respect to the date. So I'm going to choose date histogram and the date field, and I'm putting it on the interval of a daily basis. So now you can see how the cases increase on the daily basis. Now you can see now okay, let me just come back here and see the sum of confirmed cases. So now we are standing at 2.2 million cases. So if I use this serial difference thing, this is a little tricky thing. So this will give me the values on the daily basis, because in the chart this is showing the cumulative figures. But if somebody wants to say that how cases increase on the daily basis, because that is going to be like zigzag thing, so that is not going to be some chart like this. So we can now save this visualization, like we call it COVID-19 and line chart. So let's create another visualization, and this time we are going to create a horizontal bar. And this time we're going to select country. And we're going to see top 15 countries. And let me call it confirm. So now it is giving a cumulative sum of countries so far. So US on the top, but this is again showing the cumulative figure. Now here I can use this serial difference thing. So I'm taking date as well.
We can show one of your own visualizations from the original one.
Okay. So quickly, we will see all these things in detail after the Q&A session, but let me just quickly go through over the map thing. We can fix all these small things in later. So as we have already created the map, mapping, so we can create a map. Here you can add the layer in the documents. If your index is geo-enabled, that will pop up here in the list. So we have already created the geo-point mapping for our index, so it will pop up here. If I click it and select the date range, let me call last, let's say 35 days. So you can see a lot of the circle points on the world map. So in order to create a meaningful visualization, so I have an idea in mind. Let's give these circle points size as the number of confirmed cases. So it will give us some meaningful map. So let me call it confirm cases. And here in layer style, we have the symbol size, and it is now fixed to 6. So what I'll do is I'll change it to by value, and I'll select the confirmed cases. So now you can see that. Let me just decrease it to 20, maybe. So the countries which are having the bigger circles, they have more indexes. I can even do this thing with the color as well. So let's see color. And I can have it on some different, maybe on desk. So this is how you can create your maps. And you can you can save this map as a COVID-19 map. There's another quick thing. So this is a point map, and you can also set what should be the tooltip fields: country name, confirmed as date, and recover. So whenever you hover on any point, you'll see all these details. So this is India. On this date, if I particularly select a date like 16th of April, like yesterday, now you can see. So if I hover on India, so this is showing me there are 13,430 confirmed cases with 448 deaths so far, and almost 1700 people have been successfully recovered. So if you see the Pakistan stats, there are total 6919 confirmed cases with 128 deaths with 1600 recovered cases. And you can see that the virus is hitting hard on Europe and America, with America being on the top with 6,67,000 confirmed cases with 32,000, oh my God, deaths with 54,000 people recovered. So this is yet another way of mapping data on the country boundaries. So as we don't have this boundary data, but this is built in the mapping part, you can hide this layer for time being and add another layer. Then there's this option with EMS boundary. So this is a built-in feature of Kibana. Here you see the world countries. So you can have it on the state level as well. Like if you want to see the spread of disease in different states of America, you can have that. But let me do it on the world boundaries. So if you click this world boundary, see the world boundary layer is being drawn on the map. Then you can add it. And you just have to join this with your existing data, so that you can plot your data on these world boundaries, or you can give some shades of color with respect to confirmed or death cases. So I'll just join this with the name, and in the right source, I'll select my index, and then I'll select country and the region name. Okay. So after that, I'm going to use the matrix. I'm going to sum the confirmed cases, and I'll call it confirm and save it. Now, see if you hover on any country, let me just tooltip the name. Now you can see the name and the confirmed cases in Pakistan, So what exactly this is doing, this is, you know, joining two different layers on the fly. One layer is coming from the Kibana server, Elasticsearch server, and one is your index pattern. And then it is, you know, putting it on the map. I'll quickly apply the fill color on the confirmed cases. And I'll select this yellow to red shade or corplet. So now you can see that this is showing different countries color wise. So I can save it. And now you can hover any country and it will give you the confirmed cases in that country. So you can have as many visualization here. I'll just sum it up by creating a very, very basic dashboard. So we just sum up this session and move to the question and answer session. We will definitely come here again. So the final thing is how to combine all these visualization together to create one impactful dashboard. Okay. So if I go to my default workspace, let me just show you the dashboard that I have created already. I'll just show you the capability where to add the visualization. So if you add it, there's this option of adding visualization into your dashboard. So all the visualizations will come here. Like if I select this average sale price visualization here, so it will come down. You can increase or decrease the size of the visualization or anything. So what I have done, I created all these visualizations separately and then combined them together to create this one impactful map. So guys, that's all for the practical part of this session. So we will just move on to the question and answer session. And let's see what Sami has for us. So in the existing dashboard that I created for you guys, you see these three are the gauge visualizations where you visualize one indicator in the form of an average or sum or something, one value per indicator. So you can give it any color range or anything. So if the data range increases, the color increases automatically. So that's all. I'll now give control to Mr. Sami to moderate this question and answer session. I hope I'll be able to give you some insight of this presentation. Thank you so very much, guys.
Hey guys, can you hear me?
Sure. What do you suppose?
Hey,
after
hi, my name is Tamur.
Suppose you come to find that there is some discrepancies left in the graph. So what you can do, you can edit the dashboard, and you can click any visualization, and you can edit that visualization. It will take you to the visualization thing. So here you can see that I have just done nothing because there is nothing in the bucket part. I have just added, you can see, top hit of depth. So this is just showing the top hit value in the depth column. So this is showing how many deaths have been done over the past 3 months. So this is how you can edit any visualization, and that edit would reflect in the final dashboard. So let's go to this COVID death line visualization. So if you see this visualization in the time range, there is this last three months value is selected. And here in the bucket, so this is date histogram on daily. And then there is a term aggregation on the country. So I have put top five. I can decrease it like top two. And in the metric part, I have summed the deaths. So you can see that this is now showing only two countries. So you can have as many countries on the map. So I have just kept it to five just to avoid the clutter. So in every visualization, the theme is same. So this is a panel setting for the theme. Either you want to have your legend on the top or on the right or anything. So these are the aesthetic options. So you can play around with them. Even in the metric and axis. So you can have one, you can have it like bar. See, you can have it like area. And you can have it line. So I can even, if I have two matrices, I have them stacked one on them. So as you can see in this, so the countries are actually stacked. So you can say there's France on the top, and then US and, so you can play around all these settings to come up with, you know, the more meaningful charts. So
Himanshu has a question. He asked me this earlier also, but he asked that when you were making these graphs, you must have been thinking that these graphs tell a story. So can you say that this graph tells this story and this graph tell that story from this point of view? Like, what story does this graph tell and what story does the line chart graph tell?
Okay. Thank you, Himanshu, for asking this wonderful question. So you are actually looking at this dashboard from a storytelling perspective. So that is also possible in dashboard. You can put as much text or as much image or anything else. You want to portray this dashboard as a storytelling thing. By the way, the main theme of the dashboard is all the visualizations are actually linked together. So whenever you put any filter on top of the dashboard, so all the visualizations are actually synchronized with each another. Let me just show you one thing. Suppose I want a filter of the country. Let's say I call it India. So if you see, all the visualizations are, you know, filtered according to the global filter which I selected. So in story telling, there is yet another powerful way of creating dashboard where you keep all these visualizations non-dependent on each another. So the different components will not be dependent on each other. Like if you change the date, some of the components will remain same. So that is again a tricky part of this. You can have like two indexes, index patterns, one with the date range and the other one without the date range. So this is how you can have different stories. And there is another answer to this question as well. There is yet another powerful feature of Kibana. They call it Canvas. In the Canvas, Canvas is just like the dashboard, but it is more of a storytelling, you know, kind of thing, where you can have the presentation style of dashboards, where you can even play your dashboards. Let me just show you some of the dashboards already built in as a sample data. Like so this is the e-commerce data. So this is a sample.
Himanshu is asking, is there any reason you put the gauge at the top and the numbers at the side and the line charts on the left, or specific reason for that, or the order in which you put the visualization?
Yes, Himanshu has asked another wonderful question. So the putting visualizations on the different angle, on the different size, this is completely based on your idea, how you want to put up all the information inside for your viewers. So this was in my imagination that I'll put these gauges on the top to give the top stats first to the viewer, and then go deep down to the countries. If you look at the other, if I show you the other dashboards, the sample dashboard, so people have put up different, you know, information differently on the dashboard. So this is a sample e-commerce dashboard. See, they have put different visualizations. And finally the table as well. So this is completely your imagination, how you want to see your insights, how you want to present your insight to your audience or the viewers. I hope this is the answer of your question. Okay. Any other question, guys? Okay, so Mr. Taimur Qureshi has asked, how do you save a specific dashboard? So whenever you are creating a dashboard, so let's just jump to our workspace where we have created two visualizations and see this thing practically. Let me also give you another tip. In Elastic Search Elk Stack in Kibana, you can create many spaces. So these spaces are actually transparent to each another. So like if you have like five people working in your team, analyzing different dimensions of that data, so you can create one space for one person. So they will not confuse with visualization and the dashboards of other. So if we, so we have these in the visualization, we have this line chart and we have this map as well. So we want to put these two visualizations on a dashboard and then save. So hopefully that is going to be the answer to Tamu's gracious question. So I'm going to create a new dashboard. I'm going to add line chart first and then map. So actually two line charts are being added. So let me put it relative to last 2 months update. See, I can have these two visualizations side by side. I can just increase the size. So once you are done with your aesthetic, you know, things, you can even add your filters, or you can even save these date range values and the filter in the dashboard as well. See, if I click the save button, so you can save it like COVID Elastic webinar. So you can put some description about COVID-19 dashboard webinar and store time with dashboard as well. If I save it, so this dashboard is saved. So I can have multiple dashboards here and I can open them up anytime afterwards. Okay, so Sameen, do we have more questions or we need to wind this up?
I've answered all the questions.
Okay, that's great, gentlemen. It was really nice to talk to you guys, and I hope that I'm being able to add up something in your existing knowledge, and I hope that this will be beneficial for you. So thank you so very much. So I'm taking leave. And Mr. Sami will resume his session now onwards.
Yeah, so thank you everyone for participating so far. So my talk is going to start in a couple of minutes. Actually, in a couple of seconds, let me just make sure that I have. So I'm going to share my desktop, and as soon as you guys can see it, I'll resume. can you see the dashboard? Yeah, okay. Okay, so let me begin. Okay, thank you. So just a quick introduction about myself. My name is Samuel Ajan. I'm head of software development at TPL Maps in Pakistan. So TPL Maps is providing mapping services as a service, and both as a web application and a mobile application for Pakistan. And so I joined this company back in around August, September of 2017. And at that time, I took over software development. Rizwan over here was head of data. And we just kind of stumbled upon Elasticsearch. And we very quickly realized that it is so much more valuable than just a simple search tool. So I hope I can explain a little bit about our experience with Elasticsearch. And then I will give an example using the same COVID data that we have. So we have a reference from that as well. But I'm also looking at the question answer session. There's going to be question answer session afterwards as well. But if somebody wants to ask, I can answer in the middle of the talk as well. So first we will talk about like why would anybody consider Elasticsearch? Then Elasticsearch is actually this should be Elastic ecosystem, because Elasticsearch is owned by a company called Elastic, and they have a complete ecosystem for developers and for people in system infrastructure. And then I will give an example, and there's a couple of tricky parts that you need to know. And if you know them, then it's going to be easier for you. And then we have a Q&A after that. So Elasticsearch primarily is for building search experience, a multilingual search experience. So if you go to Google search and you search for something, it will give you hints about, did you type that correctly? And did you type that correctly? It gives you suggestions. It auto completes for you. So those kinds of things. And if you type a word, incomplete word, it completes it for you. So those kinds of things, those are search specific. So in databases, generally you either query for data or you search for data. So those are two separate things. So searching also involves tokenizing these strings and doing different kind of analysis on those strings so that they can be searchable rather than used as queries. It is different from substring matching, because for example, if you search for the singular of a word and the plural exists, search will be able to find it. A search algorithm will be able to find it. So Elasticsearch is used primarily for search. It is also used primarily as a time series database. So if you have a data source where data is flowing in after every few seconds, minutes, hours, days, then Elasticsearch is a good database to use in that case. Prometheus is another one, and there are other ones as well. Relational data. So Elasticsearch is actually not good for relational data. So if you have a database system where you have a lot of relations, for example, if you have a classroom based project and you want to have a class and you want to have a course and grade for that course and students, so you will understand there are a lot of one-to-one, one-to-many, many-to-one, many-to-many relationships. So in Elasticsearch, you cannot join the data. So it is not a really good idea to use this, because it will take you a long time to actually figure out the data modeling for that. So unless you are actually very familiar with this, at the top, like it is not really a good idea unless you're really, really expert with Elasticsearch and you need know how to embed those documents without actually increasing the size of documents beyond a certain size, those kind of things. So if there's a relational database problem, it's probably not the first choice. Like we personally prefer Postgres for relational type of relationships, but for time series kind of data, this is the best choice. So when it comes to search, you have different things like
So if you look for search, you can find different kind of projects. You will hear about Lucene, you'll hear about Solr, you'll hear about Elasticsearch, and there's also a full text search available in different databases, like Postgres has it, MongoDB has it. Now Lucene is a project that was started a few years ago, and Elasticsearch is actually built around Lucene. Similar to that, Solr is built around Lucene. Elasticsearch is actually a better option, I think, because it is a much more mature project and it's a much more mature ecosystem that exists. So if you want to host Elasticsearch, what are the options? One is that Elastic Cloud offers managed Elasticsearch, and they have a 14-day free trial period, and then they have a $16 per month subscription afterward, which is not too expensive for the kind of features that they offer. Then AWS has their own Elasticsearch hosting, so you can use that, or you can use it on-prem. So you can have your own virtual machines, or ideally virtual machines, not containers, and deploy your Elasticsearch database on those and create a cluster. We use a third approach, since we are a company that collects location data based in Pakistan, it is kind of a legal thing that it has to be in Pakistan. And so we do everything on-prem. It's slightly harder to do this on on-prem than on a cloud service provider like AWS, but Elastic is actually really good. So it solves a lot of problems for us. So Elastic Cloud has a very large ecosystem. So if you typically use Elasticsearch or the Elastic Stack to manage and monitor your cluster of machines that have services, databases, front end, and other kind of project services running on them, you can use a lot of different projects that are all provided by Elastic, and they're all free to use. They're all, I think most of them or all of them are open source as well, I'm not sure. But they're all free to use. So if you want to monitor network data, there is something called PacketBeat, which is a very lightweight service which you can deploy on each machine. If you want to monitor your CPU, memory, disk usage, then you can use MetricBeat, which is another very lightweight service. If you want to parse your files, you can use something called FileBeat, and they have parsers for Nginx, HAProxy, and a lot of other formats. You can modify them, you can adapt them as well. If you want to have audit checks on a machine, security related audit, for example, who logged in with the correct password, who logged in with the wrong password, you have AuditBeat for that. If you want to see how long your services were up and available and whether they were down or not, you have Heartbeat for that. It's another service. And if you want to implement tracing or distributed tracing even, you have a project called APM, which is relatively new and it is really, really nice. So if you want to implement distributed tracing with the open source, really mature, good project, then APM is the one for that. And for visualization, we have Kibana, which Rizwan has just told you. So in addition to that, if you use these projects, we typically use Ansible to do configuration over, so code-based configuration, like the all the configuration of our system. So we have 30 plus VMs that we manage, and Ansible is very helpful for us. So we can create a state for each of our machine for all of these beats. In addition to that, we use a lot of curl and Postman. And the reason is that Elasticsearch, like in different databases, you have database drivers. So Postgres has its own database driver and MongoDB has its own. And the really cool thing about Elastic is that you can talk to it over HTTP, over REST. So the REST verbs like get, put, post, they all work, and you can create indexes, delete them, change some of the settings, change some of the state of the cluster, those kind of things that's possible just by using your REST API. We also use, so if you have a paid subscription, Elasticsearch has something called alerting. So if you can put an alert that if my disk space goes below 80%, then send me an alert either through an email or through an SMS or through, for example, Slack notification. So you can use that. We use an open source project called Elast Alert, which is by Yelp. And this actually listens to our Elasticsearch data indices. It polls them on a periodic basis. And if we have an error, if you have a problem, then it alerts us to Slack, for example. Then there's a RabbitMQ project called Elastic Dump, which you also use if you want to migrate from one Elasticsearch cluster to another one. Elasticsearch has its own options for doing that as well. but we are actually a little bit more comfortable using Elastic term, but you can migrate one Elasticsearch cluster to another one as well. So yeah, so these are some examples. So in TPL maps, we have a lot of streaming data that is coming in, and this is actually screenshots from our actual data. So for example, this shows us our API access logs. So people use our APIs for dialing, for geolocation, for reverse geolocation, for traffic data, all those kind of things. So this shows how many files are actually being created. So or rather how many records are being created throughout the day. So this appears on Kibana on the landing dashboard page, and we can very quickly see whether the kind of trend that we have. So it shows that at night we don't have too many people using our service, but during the day, for example, we have a lot of people who are using our service. So before the COVID situation, the numbers were actually much higher than this, but this gives a good trend of what's going on. So the graph below is actually one of our services. We were using APM to monitor that. And we can see that which part of the service is taking up how much time. So our app is a Java application. We can see how much time that is taking, how much time does the HTTP communication itself takes, how much time does Postgres take, and how much time does, for example, the rediscussion that we use, that takes. So based on that, we can actually look at different parts of the application and see where we want to optimize. So that comes from APM, and that's again really helpful and really useful. So another dashboard that we have is that, for example, we can see the CPU usage of average of every machine that we have, and we can also filter this out. We can also look at different network events, and we can see how many DNS queries were made, how many TLS handshakes were there. This kind of information is also available. If we use metric, be it and packet, be it and ordered, be it, if you configure them, then we can have a really nice overview of our system, and we can see if there are any problems, if there are any intrusions, if there are any performance bottlenecks, security issues that we can identify. And then this is, so the graph on the top, this shows actually, so we have some system monitors which actually monitor system all the time. And if we have, something is down, then we get an alert. And if you see historically at what time your services were up or down, then we can see it in a very nice graph like this. So this is the graph that is above. The graph that is below, that is similar to the one before. In this, you can see the CPU usage and the system memory usage, and you can see some other parts of the stack, the heap memory and the non-heap memory, how that performs over a period of time. And so if you're wondering like, why is the heap memory fixed or why is the non-heap memory fixed, then typically what we do with Elastic is that in Elastic, you need to fix the memory before you actually run the service, so the memory has to be fixed. And there are different performance reasons for that. So when you run Elasticsearch in production, there are some guidelines for that, and you need to follow those guidelines. And we do that, so we get a typical kind of graph, and so this is why it looks like this. So Elasticsearch So Elasticsearch actually talks on REST. So you can talk to the Elastic cluster on a certain port. You can send REST requests on a certain endpoint. And the Elasticsearch cluster talks, the Elasticsearch cluster nodes talk to each other also on a certain port, on a certain endpoint. And Elasticsearch has something, so there is something called Raft, which is a consensus-based protocol. So typically for NoSQL databases, you need to have an odd number of nodes, 3 or 5 or 7 or more. And that lets, in case one of the nodes goes down, the other nodes do an election among themselves and they elect one of them as a leader, and the node operations continue, whether they're reading or writing. So Elastic uses a protocol similar to Raft. It's a little bit more advanced than that, but typically when you look at NoSQL databases like MongoDB and Elastic, they will use some kind of variation of the Raft protocol, and Elastic uses that as well. And Elasticsearch distributes the data based on shards and replicas. So shard is a horizontal divide of the data. So if you have a database that has 1 million records and you have 3 shards, Elasticsearch will probably divide it into 300,000 records per shard, and a replica is a copy of the shard. So for a 3-node cluster, we would typically have 1 master shard and 2 replicas. So that would distribute all the data across all nodes, and so that's important for reliability. And how you configure the shard and how you configure the replicas also has an effect on performance, but that is something that is a bit more involved, and you need to know how the shards and replicas work, how searching across different nodes works. So it's a bit more involved. But if you're actually going to do something, actually going to put a lot of data and do a lot of search on it, this is something that you need to be aware of. And Elasticsearch, this is a good thing as well, that when you add more data, Elasticsearch automatically balances the shards. So you don't need to tell it that it needs to be redirected to this shard or to that shard. And it's not that difficult to scale from a few nodes to hundreds of nodes. So Elasticsearch can rebalance that. Obviously, you have to be careful about different issues. But it's not that hard actually to scale out Elasticsearch clusters. So when you are writing data to Elasticsearch, the most important thing, just like with any NoSQL database, is that you need to model the data. You need to see how your data will look like. So typically, when Rizwana and I were modeling different kinds of visualization or different kind of scenarios, we would spend a day or 2 days just on modeling the data, on how the data would look like in the database based on what kind of insights we needed from that. And the issue is that once you model the data and you write it to the database, and if you declare that it's a string and then you try to change the data type from string to, let's say, date, then that won't work. So you need to either create a new attribute of type date and copy that data over there, or you need to create a new index altogether. So that is something that you need to be careful about and think about before. So it's kind of like in SQL, when you create a table and you want to change the type of the column in the table, it's kind of like doing that. So in Elastic, you can't do that. Another thing you need to think about is whether your data is read heavy or write heavy. So for example, our search data, we sync it and we write it to our Elasticsearch database on maybe a daily basis or a weekly basis, depending on how regularly we get that. But the search happens like all the time, every day. There are hundreds of thousands and up to millions of requests per day. So our data is actually not write heavy, but read heavy. So we need to model according to that. As opposed to that, our data that comes from our Meetrix and from our packet beat service and a metric beat service, that is write heavy, but it's not read heavy. So we don't read it that frequently, but it gets written a lot frequently. So for example, our packet beat data, that can easily go into petabytes. It can go up to more than one petabyte for a 30 node cluster. So you need to be aware of that. You need to make sure that a cluster stays healthy. It does not consume your disk space very fast. Then you need to see how you define the shards and replicas, and that's a kind of an involved process. So the reason why I'm telling you all this is it's not so hard to get started, definitely not, but there is a learning phase, and it's actually very useful and very valuable learning phase, because the kind of concept that you learn in Elasticsearch and in Kibana, they're applicable to other NoSQL databases as well. So they are all very relatable to each other. So it's a very good knowledge to gain, but it's not like magic. You just put data inside and everything just works and it keeps working for the next 3 years. Nothing will happen. So you need to be aware of what's happening inside the system. So I will give an example now. So so what I've done is that I've created an Elasticsearch cluster. I'm running it on Docker. So I'll just make sure that it's running. So I have, I basically use the simple developer way of running an Elasticsearch, a node, single node. So I will actually publish this on a GitHub page somewhere, and you can use this afterwards. And I use a Kibana node to communicate with this Elastic node. And I can show you these running on over here. So this is running on my local host, and this is Kibana. What Rizwan was showing you, that was running on Elastic Cloud, right, Rizwan? And I'm running this on my own machine. And so you can see that over here, I'm calling localhost 9200, and this is actually the endpoint where you, you talk to the database. So you can call different endpoints on this URL, and it will you can write data, read data, get more information about it. For example, there is the CAT API. So what the CAT API does is that it tells you in a human readable format different kind of information. So we have these four indexes right now. So this is the health of the index. So the health of the index depends on the kind of shards and replicas you have assigned for the system, and so it's indication of that. Green is good, yellow is not good, red is really bad, but that depends on different settings that you have. So right now I have this one index that I created, and these are the meta indices or the system indices that Elastic uses internally to manage its to manage Kibana. And this shows the doc count, and this shows the store, the amount of data that is stored in kilobytes. And over here, so in Kibana, you can go to management, and then you can go to index management, and it will show you the same index over here. If you include system indices, you will see the other ones as well. You can see this over here as well. So when we started out, because we didn't know much about Elasticsearch, we did not use Kibana that much, so we use mostly the Elastic API itself, the HTTP API, and once we discovered Kibana, we use this a lot now because it's actually kind of helpful. It has autocomplete in some places, it shows other information in other places, so it's actually quite helpful. So what I'm going to do right now is, so I will just delete this index, and I will recreate this index again. So I've deleted this, and I will use a data source, which is actually this one. So I think this is the same data source that Rizwan was using. What this does is it has CSV data in this format. The only thing about this is that every row has a country, and then you have dates and columns, right? So ingesting this kind of data in this format into Elastic is not a good idea because Elastic is very friendly towards time series based data, where you every document represents a certain time rather than one document with a bunch of times inside that, because every time you get a new time, you will have to modify an existing document. So it's not generally a good idea to do that. I personally don't like doing that. So what I do is that I modify this so that every row and every column is actually one document. So for example, over here, if we have 100 columns over here, this will actually turn into 100 documents. It means there are more documents, but it means that it is easier to do the visualization that we have in Kibana. So the way I do that, sorry, I have a sore throat. So the way I do this is, so I wrote a Python script for this. What this does is that it opens a certain CSV file, the one that I showed you over there. Then it runs two for loops. So it goes for every row and then for every column. And then it basically creates an object where that date is saved, the province, region, the latitude, longitude, and then there's some other metadata that I will show in a minute, and that's written to the file. So what this does is, So what this does is that, so when I run this, so I run it like this. So I run it like this. So I have an input, have an out, and then I redirect the standard out to a certain file. When I run this, I just get this kind of data. So this is actually not valid JSON because it's, so you have one JSON document on one file, then you have another one on one line, then another one on another line. Actually, Elasticsearch expects data to be in this format. So the first row, is the metadata, which means that what is the name of the index in which this needs to be written and what is the ID of the document that needs to be written. So if I remove the ID over here, then that's fine. Elastic will create an ID itself. It doesn't need an ID. But when I mention the ID, what it does is it does an upsert. So if the value for this document ID already exists, it will override this. Otherwise, it will leave it. So there was a question from one of the viewers that what happens when you get the same data again. So if you specify the ID based on certain attributes, then the ID is overwritten with the old one. And you don't need to worry about having the same data twice. Because if you have a total number of something and you add the same data twice, then the number is going to get doubled. So for example, for something like this, if I'm uploading the whole data set again and again, with only a difference of a few documents at the end, I would either parse the document to only add the new documents or add the whole document, making sure that the old ID is replaced. So that is an approach. You can take either one of those. I took this one. There is no particular reason for this. I just prefer this right now. So I use this approach. And once you have this data, so what we can do is I will just show you that you can run actually a curl command. So the index that I deleted over there, I could actually delete it using curl as well. So curl-x delete. So this will send a HTTP delete command to the index and delete it. If you want to create a new index, what you do is you give the server URL, which is localhost running on port 9200, and you give the index name, and then you can put pretty at the end because the data result that you get, it should be pretty printed. So run it over here, and it shows me that, you know, acknowledged true, shard acknowledged true, and the index has been confirmed. If I try to do this again, it will say that resource already exists exception. If I don't use pretty, it comes up something like this, which is a pain to read, right? So I use pretty at the end just to make sure it looks like this. Once I've done that, I will upload the mapping for this. So this is what the mapping looks like. So we have an entry date type field, which is of type date, and we have a location field of type geopoint. So over here, we have an entry date, which is this. So this is year dash month dash day. And then we have a location, which is an object with two attributes, lat and long. So this is actually, if you want to see, somebody might be asking, why is it lat long? Why not lat long? Why not lat LNG? So Elastic actually specifies this very clearly that if you want to create a geopoint data type, these are the attributes that you need to use, or this is the pattern of the attribute that you need to use, the spelling, you know, those kind of things. So you need to be careful about that. So Elastic says that if you create, one of the ways to specify geopoint is to have it in an object with the lat and long spelling based object. So I specify that and then I write the mapping. So it's actually quite a simple thing that I'm doing over here. So what I'm telling is that I want to post, so there are different attributes for different actions. So if you want to update the information in an index, then you need to use the post variable. HTTP verb. And there's a header tells it that it's a type of application, XND.json. And the data is coming from this file. And the endpoint that we're calling is the same one that we had above, but there's an underscore mapping at the end. So change the mapping of this index. So we will run this, and this will update the mapping of this particular endpoint. So it will know that this endpoint has this field, which is of this type. So if you go here, back here, and we reload the indices, so this came back. And if you click here, we can go to the mapping, and we can see that these two mappings are actually specified. So whenever it gets the date, it's supposed to get this. So we have this, and then lastly, we will write this data. So I will actually just, I won't write the data. I will just show what we're writing. So what this is doing is that it was sending a post request with this header. So you need to specify the header, and you're specifying the source file. And you're also actually calling the same endpoint with the index name followed by underscore bulk. So Elastic has different APIs. So there's a document API, there's the index API, there's the bulk API. So the bulk API is used to add a very large number of documents in one go, and it handles it more efficiently. But before you add that, you need the documents need to be in a certain format. So for every document that you add, the first row needs to have an index, an optional ID, and the data itself. So this is all repeated. You can see that there's index for this, and then there's data itself, and index for this, and a document itself. And once we do that, this will actually add the data, and it shows you that so for every document, it shows this update. It shows you the index where it was added, the ID of that document, the version of the document, whether it was created or updated, how many shards you have, sequence number, and other information. And 201 mean document created. If I run this again, this was a question asked that what happened when you add the same data again? Because the index number is actually specified, what this does is that this document is actually updated. It changes the version number to 2 and status is 200, which means that it was not created, it was just updated. And we have the same number of records over there. So we can see one more thing. So let me see how much time I have. So I think I'll just wrap it up in like a few minutes. So when we go over here, this will show us the number of records these were received. This is not the number of infections, number of confirmed cases, or deaths. This is just the date in the record that was received. So a quick way to visualize this data is to just go here and click visualize. So the location data we can visualize on a map very quickly like this. And this is again a count. Instead of count, we can do a sum of, this was actually correct in the beginning. So count is the number of cases that are available at that area. So that's one way of seeing the data. And then we can go ahead and build the visualization. So for example, just like Iswan showed you can do a canvas, you can do a dashboard, you can do a visualization. There's one more thing I want to show, is that if you go to a dashboard, so I'll just go to Rizwan's dashboard over here. So Rizwan made this dashboard. You would see that there is a share option, right? And then you have an embed code option, and then you have a snapshot option, and then a saved object option. So if you click the saved, so this snapshot is actually something you can go and share with a friend. And if they change the dashboard, they won't change the original dashboard, they will change their own version of the dashboard. If you put a saved object option and copy iframe code, you can actually put this in an application. So this particular dashboard that Rizwan was showing with you, this had a username password behind it. So anybody who does not have a username password to this dashboard, so there's a role-based access control in Kibana as well, which is really, really good. So Rizwan used that to log into this through this dashboard. But in case you want to show it on a friend, or you want to put it on a website and you want other people to see it as well, and then you don't want them to log into the machine, and you don't want to expose it to everyone also at the same time, because if you don't have security, then everybody has read-write access both. So you want to share this, you want to put it in your own website. So what you can do is you can copy the iframe code from here, and then you can create a file called, for example, index.html, right? So it has to be index.html. So what I did was I created a basic HTML file and I copied this iframe over here, right? So this was copied over here. I changed the height and the width a little bit, and I put this over here. And the next thing I did was that I created a GitHub project, which is, let me just put this down. So I created a GitHub project, and I uploaded my index.html up to this public open project. So it's github.com/samyujan/elastic-covid-webpage. And over here, if you go to settings, you will see an option that says GitHub pages. So right now it is enabled, but you can go over here and click enable. And this will actually write another file to your repository, which is this one, _config.yml. And this creates, and this allows you to publish your page, your static page on GitHub itself. So if you know about single page applications or static pages, you don't need an Apache server or a PHP server or anything. You can just put it on a URL like S3 or on a GitHub page itself or Netlify, and it will host it for you. So if you put an index file inside and you turn on this option of publishing GitHub page, you get something like this. So if you see over here, samyujan.github.io/elastic-talk.covid, which is my own personal GitHub username.github.io/my repository name is actually now a web page. And there is no username password behind this, but I'm seeing the same dashboard that I that is available on Elastic Cloud, which Rizwan created and published. So if you want to create your own dashboard and you want to show it to your friends and you don't want to have that Elastic, you know, filters, you do have filters, but you don't have the other options available, all of these available. You don't want these to be there because these are actually quite unnecessary and they're more annoying than they're useful. So this is attested on my local machine using HTTP server, which is an NPM package to test on your own machine. And this is actually published on GitHub. And anybody can go and see this, and you can share it with your friends, and you can ingest it. So there's another question that somebody asked, which is that, what if somebody wants to consume this data in real time? So actually, I tried to look for that a while ago. I could not find it. I will look again, and if I find it, I will share it on my GitHub page. But what I would typically do is that I would use a Lambda function from AWS or Netlify or Microsoft Azure or Firebase, and that would be triggered by a GitHub webhook. So every time somebody pushes data to a GitHub a repository, which is managing, on which you have already have COVID data. So for example, this URL that has COVID data, which is updated, the CSV file is updated every 12 hours. So every time that file is updated, that webhook would call your serverless function. And that would read that CSV file, change it, and then push it to your Elastic Cloud. And that would get updated immediately. And the last update time, you can show it somewhere above here on the web application. So that is something that you would do, and it would just work out on its own. And one last thing, so the filters are still here, so you can still do stuff like you can do a country is, you know, for example, United Kingdom. And so all those things that Rizwan showed you, those still work. So that's it for me. The talk is over from my side. If somebody has any questions, please let me know.